Welcome back. Today we are going to dive into GATs and how they're used. Now, GATs, or generic associated types, are a fairly large subject, and it's a subject that the Rust community is now enabled to work with on stable Rust because the feature was released in 1.65. So that means that we'll see not just the set of applications for GATs that people thought of in the RFC, but also the things that people now figure out that they can do because they are able to experiment with it on the stable Rust release. The original RFC was submitted almost 6.5 years ago in 2016. And I encourage you to read this if you're going to use GATs in your applications because it explains the motivation, the whys and the hows and things like that, and gives additional examples and motivating reasons for implementing GATs in the language at all. Today, we're going to go over a specific example. We're going to skip all the type theory. We're not going to explain why GATs are GATs or mention any fancy type theory terms. Today, all we're looking at is the practicality of a concrete example and what GATs enables us to do. The very first thing we should mention is that GATs are generic associated types, which means that we're taking a feature of the Rust language called associated types and making it more generic. An associated type, if you're not aware, is a feature that we use when we're talking about making our own traits and implementing those traits. Any trait, such as this one called contains, can define types that are called associated types. These are types associated with a trait. And these types have to be provided by the implementer of this trait. So here we've got the trait contains. We've got type A and type B that have to be defined by the implementer. So this is the trait definition. And we've got a function called contains that uses a reference to self A, which is this type A, and self B, which is this type B. An implementation of that trait could look something like this. We could define type A, the associated type A, for the trait contains that we're implementing for container. We can define A to be an I32, and we can define B to be an I32 as well. And then when we write our contains function for this implementation, number one is going to be a reference to an I32, and number two is going to be a reference to an I32. Now, this is all well and good, but these types here are kind of like base types. They're concrete types, right? They are the types that you're probably very used to working with. But there are other features of the Rust language that we would like to use in this position that previously we weren't able to. And that's where generic associated types comes from. It means specifically that we can now use generics along with some other things like lifetimes in this position. So when we define these associated types, we can make these associated types generic. And that's where we get our name for the feature from. So in this case, we have a trait called pointer family. Now, what we're defining a pointer as and whatnot doesn't really matter. Suffice it to say, we're using this trait to abstract over implementations for different container types. So here we've got an implementation that uses arc, and here we've got an implementation that uses RC. Arc and RC are what we would call pointers, or I like to think of them as container types. RC stands for reference counted, and arc stands for atomically reference counted. These are interesting data structures on their own, but I'm not going to be going over them today. For our purposes, all you really need to know is that you can take a value and you can put it inside an arc, or you can put it inside an RC. So for this pointer family trait, we define an associated type pointer that has a generic T that implements deref where the target is T. We also require the implementation of a function new that takes the generic T. So our value is the generic T and returns a self pointer, which is our associated type, parameterized by T. So we have two implementations of this trait. The first is for the struct arc family, and the second is for the struct RC family. So we take our trait and we implement pointer family, which is our trait name, for each of these structs. The pointer type, again, is generic. These are generic associated types. And for each of them, we define pointer T to be an arc T or an RC T, depending on our implementation. So we can store whatever value we want in here. And what this means is that our output value here is going to be an arc T. So our new function then takes that generic, takes in that value that we've defined as going to be the output, and just creates a new value. So because we've defined this return type, pointer t, as being argt, it's basically like we're aliasing this. So you could replace this with argt and it would be the same thing. So here we create an arc wrapping our value. And in the other example, we use rc to wrap our value. Close that for a second. And this allows us to take each of these, which now has this new function implemented on it, because we've implemented pointer family and it is unambiguous which new function this will be. So we can do an arc family new with a string or an rc family new with a string. And if we run this, the debug output for each of these values is going to be that string. This is because of the way that the debug works for arc and rc. But going further, we can take our trait, because, you know, like we could have just created an arc here or created an rc here and it would have been, you know, the same thing. We can take our trait and we can define a struct that has a generic p that implements pointer family. And we can store in some field, in this case bar, which I haven't changed because this is an example from the RFC. So I wanted to match the names. So we've got this field bar that uses the associated type pointer on p, because p implements pointer family. Pointer family has the associated type pointer, and we can define or construct the type from string to make that generic t be string. So in this case, what we've done here is abstracted over anything that implements pointer family or abstracted over any of these container types, such that we can define this struct a single time and hold any of those values. So we can see this in action. I've got arc foo and rc foo here, which are of type foo arc family and foo rc family respectively. And we can construct them both with the foo name. So it's just foo. And then the field bar is either going to be the arc we created earlier, which is an arc family, or the rc we created earlier, which is an rc family. Note that these are distinct types, because if I try to put them into a vec, we end up with one of these is an arc family or a foo arc family, and one of them is a foo rc family. And thus we can't put two different types in the same vec. But because these are both foos, we can access the bar field and get these values out. So we've used generic associated types to implement a pointer type that is generic across a number of different containers. We've implemented for each of those containers, and we've used the restriction using our generic trait to define the type for our field by using the associated type from the trait, which we know our type has implemented. And this can be done entirely generically, which means that foo will work with anything that implements the pointer family for this value. Now, this is a bit of a contrived example, really just to get you a sense of how this is used or where those generics and why we're calling it generic, or where those generics go inside of a trait. And the only other thing I would add to this example is the note that lifetimes and const generics also qualify as being used in this associated type. So we can do what we've done here with generics. We can do the same thing with lifetimes. So you can use references here now, or you can use const generics as well. The most common feedback I hear about GATs is, I don't even know what that would look like. So I hope this example gave you a little bit of insight into what the physical code looks like, so that you can start jumping off into maybe the RFC to get a deeper understanding of when you would use this and how you would use this in your own projects. So that's it for today. I'll catch you in the next video, and have a great day.